Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night. Tonight's guest is Rebecca Kiesling.
How are you doing?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Where she will be making a secular case against abortion through no exceptions, rape, all that stuff.
Yeah, it's nice having you on. Like I said before the show came on, I actually first learned about you through Secular Pro-Life, and your story got around a lot. You seem to be actually a very big inspiration to many pro-lifers that I've actually known.
I appreciate that. I've been speaking for 26 years now. I speak nationally, internationally, but I do a lot of writing too. And I mentioned to you that I wrote a philosophical abortion essay. If you Google philosophical abortion essay, like, it's usually ranked on Google anywhere from number one to number three. And it's a 43-page essay, The Right of the Unborn Child Not to be Unjustly Killed, The Philosophy of Rights Approach. It's wholly secular in nature. I took the top abortion philosophers, followed their arguments, show the error in their logic. I used a lot of legal principles. I wrote it when I was in law school. And a very sound document. Love to challenge anyone to it.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually wrote a book myself on abortion, defending pro-life. So, yeah, it's always good to have some authors around here.
So let's get right to the heart of the matter. A lot of objectors will tell you, how about you be in their shoes? Would you like to carry a baby that's the product of someone who took your innocence away or any of that?
That's not usually the way they say it. Product is definitely a dehumanizing term. It sounds like you're some kind of byproduct, which is usually has a negative connotation.
That's what pro-death advocates usually say.
They usually say things like rape baby, which is interesting because we always are called, unborn children are always called a fetus, except when they were conceived in rape. Then they actually are afforded the dignity of being called baby. On the one hand, they acknowledge our humanity by referring to that child as a baby. But you'd never hear them say rape fetus, but they say, rape baby.
You also never say fetus shower.
But they call us rapist child. You never hear them say rape victim's child. And that's what I am. I'm the child of a rape victim. And I challenged a reporter one time who referred to me as rapist child, and I corrected her. And then she was very condescending to me and said, it is a biological fact, is it not, that you are the child of a rapist? And I said, it's also a biological fact that I'm a child of a rape victim, but you chose not to say that, didn't you? You chose to just ascribe me as belonging to the rapist, and she just gulped. She did not expect me to fight back. It's like, oh crap, you fight back? They say stuff like that, rapist child, child of rape. So first of all, whenever you hear rapist child or rape baby or anything like that, immediately correct them and say rape victim's child.
It's kind of putting them alongside a crack baby or a one-night stand baby or stuff like that.
You don't hear anybody call Obama polygamous child, right? Yeah. Mm. it's what he is, right? But why would anybody say that? I'm an attorney, and I practiced family law for years. And when I practiced, when I had my practice many years ago as a young attorney, they changed the name of the statute from the Paternity Act to the Parentage Act. But the legal definition of the child conceived out of wedlock was just that, child conceived out of wedlock. But in the 1970s, before they changed the definitions, before they changed it to the Paternity Act, it used to be called the Illegitimacy Act, and the definition was illegitimate child. And we stopped doing that. And you think that's bad? In the 1930s, it used to be called the Bastard Act in Michigan and most other states. And the legal definition of a child conceived out of wedlock was bastard. But as a society,
not as encouraged as it is now.
Right. But the only people group where it's still okay to demonize the child based upon the choices of the parents is when it comes to the issue of rape. In no other setting are you allowed to demonize that child. You cannot say bastard anymore. You can't say illegitimate child. Now it's just child neutral terminology, child born out of wedlock. But somehow it's still socially acceptable to say rapist child or rape baby, or we get called demon seed, evil seed, horrible reminder, taint gene.
As if that's any better.
Huh?
As if that's any better than the previous terms.
And I got another new one was a rape trophy.
Yeah. I mean, it is actually interesting to note that with the whole rape baby notion, I actually didn't, like, I didn't know that they used to be more open about calling children bastards when their parents weren't married. But I did think, you know, with how PC our culture is, it sort of came out. Got out.
They
said, no, don't do that.
Right.
Usually bastard is someone's kid who doesn't know who his father is, or nobody knows, or his mother.
Well, I mean, that used to be the legal terminology. And that was in the 1930s, though, that legislators made this decision that this is unacceptable. But still, today, it's apparently acceptable to call the child, the rapist child, and reporters regularly do that. I hear, you know, political pundits, they say rape baby, rapist baby, and
well, at least they acknowledge the baby part.
Yeah, or they say monster's child.
Yeah. Now, I was actually looking on your Wikipedia, and
I've tried to get that fixed.
Well. Now you've been on the side of terminating parental rights to men who raped women and got them pregnant. I was wondering, has there ever been a worry about perhaps taking away parental rights to a falsely accused and or punished man?
Well,
and does the termination come with not paying child support or stuff like that?
Depends on the state. But first of all, terminating parental rights is a civil matter, not a criminal matter. And in civil matters, we don't use a criminal standard of beyond a reasonable doubt. The highest civil standard is clear and convincing evidence, which is considered to be like 85-90% certainty. So it's still a high burden, much higher than the normal preponderance of the evidence, which is like, you know, 50.1%, like that you're more believable. So the burden of proof is on the person seeking to terminate parental rights. And that's the normal standard in all other termination of parental rights cases. So you don't have to have a rape conviction for child molestation in order to terminate parental rights for that reason. You don't have to have a conviction for child abuse to terminate parental rights for that reason. And the U.S. Supreme Court, in the case of Santosky versus Kramer, said that clear and convincing evidence meets due process standards because it is the highest civil standard that there is. So it's not like a woman can just come in and say rape. On the other hand, when it comes to abortion, that's how it is. There's absolutely no semblance of due process whatsoever. Anywhere that you have a rape exception in the law, you know, whether it's funding of abortions or in countries where they have bans on abortion, except in cases of rape, or, you know, there's other areas of the law where they have exceptions. You can bypass parental consent in certain laws. Certain states, you don't have to have parental consent for abortion if it's rape. And all you have to do is say rape. It's like secret password, wink, wink, just say rape. And the child is sentenced to death. So this is what I ask people when it comes to the rape issue is, do you advocate for a law that would authorize rape victims to be able to pay someone to kill her rapist or just her innocent child? Because that's what abortion is. Abortion is a hit. I mean, abortionists, they're paid hitmen. They're assassins. That's exactly what it is.
That's a better word.
Yeah. And so can you imagine as a man, can you imagine if a woman just had to say rape and just like that, you get put to death, that she can pay somebody to kill you, that would be legal? And that's exactly what happens when it comes to abortion in cases of rape, except instead of the guy being killed, it's the innocent baby who's killed.
Well, you just have to assume my gender.
I said, just remember, you just assume my gender.
Oh.
Yeah.
All that I just wanted a picture of you. And your voice is coming
it's
across.
It's a joke.
Okay. All right.
I do that with on these sort of cases because... Like, if I get into an argument with a pro-choicer, what they'll say is, well, you're a man, so you can't have an opinion on abortion. I say, you just assume my gender.
Because they're normally SJWs.
Yeah, so, generally, so, now I turn their own logic on them.
Yeah.
I think that is actually pretty good. It's a very... I know it is right that the rapist father shouldn't have any parental rights as far as I know. The only thing I would perhaps it would depend on the mother if she would be interested like in child support. I would say like it figures like, you know, while he's in there, you know, have him work
Yeah, it depends on the state. Some states preserve child support. Some states preserve child support in all termination of parental rights cases. Like in Michigan, we have a Supreme Court ruling in Ray Beck that says that child support can continue in termination of parental rights cases. We also give the discretion to the mother whether or not she wants to get a waiver. Let's say if she's receiving state aid. Under federal law, the prosecutor is supposed to sue to establish paternity and child support, but there's a waiver that a rape victim can get so that it won't get referred to the prosecutor's office. And that's important. There's a lot of different levels to this. Back to the issue of you know, putting rapists to death, though, I just want to say, you know, again, like due process. The U.S. Supreme Court said in the case of Coker versus Georgia that rapists do not deserve the death penalty, that it's cruel and unusual punishment for rapists to get the death penalty. And in the second case of Kennedy versus Louisiana, the court said that even for child molesters, it is cruel and unusual punishment. So how does the innocent child deserve the death penalty for his crime?
Just have him get molested, the rapist get molested himself.
Yeah. I don't think we should do the whole eye for an eye system.
What was that?
Yeah. And personally, I'm against the death penalty because I know that our system of justice is a fiction, and I don't believe in putting a single innocent person to death. I am 100% pro-life, and there have been too many people on death row who were later exonerated. And when they got, you know, good legal counsel And so we cannot put even one innocent person to death. But yeah, they're killing innocent children for someone else's crime. And that is barbaric. So whenever you hear somebody say that it's antiquated, you know, to have no abortions and no exceptions, that countries like Peru or like Malta are antiquated, remind them that child sacrifice is what's antiquated. And when they say that it's barbaric to force a rape victim to carry that child, again, remind them that what's barbaric is a system of justice where you punish innocent people for someone else's crime.
And the science confirms that they feel the pain.
Yeah, but I don't think our rights
depending on the stage of pregnancy.
I don't think our rights should be predicated upon whether or not we feel pain. There's right. children who are born with genetic disorders that aren't all, you know, forever incapable of feeling pain. So I think that's a dangerous precedent to pass pain capable bills.
Well, yeah, it's called congenital.
No, I was just adding a
congenital analogous, I think it's called. Where or SIP,
there's
where that's where congenital insensitivity to pain. And yeah, that is a rare genetic disorder where people can't feel pain whatsoever. And yet we still think it would be wrong to kill someone that has that.
Yeah, I was just adding to the insult to injury.
Yeah. And the death penalty is just an overdose of pain medication. So do we really want to set a precedent that it's okay to kill people as long as they don't feel pain? The pain capable bill became really popular in the U.S. and it was getting pushed through in Congress by many pro-life leaders. And, you know, I would warn people, this is bad. This is not a good precedent. And sure enough, and I told people, look, the Supreme Court will just say, give them anesthesia then. And sure enough, in Montana and in Utah, they introduced a pain-capable bill, except instead of being an abortion ban, it was simply an anesthesia bill. And you had Priests for Life, Father Pavone, and other pro-life leaders were advocating for those bills, for the anesthesia bills. And I mean, do we want to train up a new generation of young people that's all that matters, is as long as they don't feel pain, it's going to be okay to kill?
No.
The only way we really know pain is by really asking someone about it. We can't sort of get inside their head.
Yeah. I mean, as long as you kill someone while they're sleeping, like, is that okay? As long as you kill people instantaneously and they don't feel pain, then it's okay to kill? Really?
Another objection. How do you answer to when they bring up the fact that, well, it's not really a fact, but they assume that most orphanages or adoption centers treat the kids like crap in foster homes. So, like, why not just put them out of their misery? They'll often say something to that effect.
Well, look, I was adopted, okay, and my adoptive family was abusive. Okay. My dad broke my nose when I was in high school. My mom was bipolar, unmedicated, undiagnosed till I was 30. And my household growing up was chaotic. Okay. And I'm here. I value my life. Thank you very much. And I prefer to be alive, not to have been killed out of your sense of empathy. What? Seriously? Is it okay to round up all orphans who are being abused and then kill them all off to put them out of their misery? Would that be okay?
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, I always use this argument. It's like, so should we just go around?
We didn't hear a word you said.
All right, I'm saying.
Hold. Okay.
Should we go around to just the homeless people and just start killing them massively and say, well, I mean, we wouldn't want them to be homeless for another day. That's going to cause so much pain and suffering. I'm like, no.
Yeah. And I have adopted children myself, including I had a baby with special needs my daughter Cassie, and she died at 33 days old. It was really medical malpractice. A doctor took her off of oxygen when she wasn't ready to be, and she stopped breathing. But she was absolutely precious, and you know, pro-life people do adopt, so it's hilarious anytime they bring it up. Well, who's going to adopt these children? You know, how many have you adopted? You know, that's what I always ask them, like, seriously. But doesn't matter. You know, every life is valuable, and you don't kill people off just because you judge that their life is not a life worth living.
And yeah. And rhetoric to add to that, they'll usually say that kids are going to be miserable, are usually miserable when they're raised by parents who didn't want them originally.
You know who I noticed that's miserable are all the abortion rights activists. Mm-hmm. They're pretty miserable people, you know? And the people, when they say that children with special needs should be killed off, you know, they'll call them incompatible with life. And the only thing that's incompatible with life is their attitude. When doctors say that, the child's going to have a heart defect, you know, no, you have the heart defect. You have the fatal heart defect, you know. These doctors are the one who have something wrong with their hearts. And it is lethal because other people are dying as a result of their heart defect.
So, just to go back to this, your background, what got you into law?
I wanted to be an attorney since I was about 10 years old. And my dad had gone to law school a few times and dropped out. He ended up becoming a professor. But he would talk to me about what the law was about. He took me to see Paul Newman in The Verdict, and he was an attorney in that movie, and he was like a hero for a victim, for the underdog. And I thought, you know, that's what I want to do. I want to be a lawyer, and I want to be an advocate and fight for the weak. I was, as I said, adopted and raised Jewish. So many of my family members had been killed in the Holocaust. And so I grew up from a very young age understanding that there's such hatred which exists in the world where people would kill innocent others. And I always wanted to fight for the underdog. I went to the elementary school where they had all of the special ed children. They were all sent to my school. And I remember having classmates make fun of these kids. You know, some of them, they were like older kids and they were at my elementary school. Those that were in the special education program. And I would play with them, you know, during recess because I couldn't stand the way that they were tormented by my classmates. So I've always had that feeling of wanting to show compassion to those who are weak and vulnerable and being targeted. When I was in high school, I remember people saying to me, you know, what do you want to be? And I'd tell them a lawyer, and they'd say, oh, like a feminist. And I asked, well, what's a feminist? I asked, what's a feminist? And they said, oh, you know, it's somebody who, like, you know, fights for women's rights, you know, and to protect women and defend women.
That's what they call it.
Yeah, and I'm like, well, yeah, you know, I'm a strong woman. I would always lifted weights and was an athlete and excelled in academics. And, you know, I was always like a fighter like that. I'm like, yeah, like a feminist. And then I started hearing that so-called feminists support abortion. And that made no sense to me. Like, what does killing babies have to do with being a strong woman?
Oh, yeah. You know about that one celebrity who made a speech congratulating herself that she had an abortion so she could, her career could get off the ground?
Mm-hmm. That's just being a bully. She's just a bully.
I don't even know who that she is.
Stella something, yeah.
Who cares?
She was the wife in the movie Greatest Showman. I liked her character in that movie. Well, kind of, but yeah. And so, yeah, you're just being, supporting women, making them stronger. And as a matter of fact, it's funny how so-called feminists will say, suggest that basically women have to be afraid of a baby. Like, How are you empowering women when you support the notion that women need to be afraid of a baby?
When he gets older?
That's not empowering women.
Because it's sort of, the implication of that is to sort of say that the male sterile body is the default good body. So that's just stupid. Like, you know, now I know you've gone over this in other chats that you've had, but how did you find out about you being conceived in rape?
I was 18 when I learned how I was conceived. I got non-identifying information from the court, and it had details about my birth mother and everything but her name. But for him, all it said was that he was Caucasian and of large build. And I mean, that's a police description, right? So I asked my caseworker, was my mom raped? And she said, yeah, I didn't want to tell you. And then I was 19 when I met my birth mother, and I heard the horrible details, how she was abducted at knife point by a serial rapist. And by the way, I found him through Ancestry DNA, like so many people from my organization say.
That actually works.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it works. I have a great relationship with my paternal half-brother, by the way. He's fabulous. I lost a half-sister to a car crash. That never got to meet her. She never married or had kids. But my biological father is a horrible man to this day. He never spent a day behind bars. And he was accused of raping a lot of his coworkers at Ford. I'm good friends with a cousin who spoke with all the women in the family and say that, yeah, he was accused of raping a lot of different women. And my brother told me he was a violent man. He has Alzheimer's now. And
why doesn't somebody go after him?
Hmm?
Why doesn't somebody go after him?
Ugh. Yeah, I don't believe in hiring hitmen.
No, I mean like getting him behind bars.
Well, unfortunately, I would. There's actually a case that's been in the news where a child conceived in rape, incest, after her mother died, she found out she was adopted. She found out how she was conceived in rape, incest, and her DNA was used, and he's being brought to trial. So, I mean, oh my gosh, I would love to have done that. But the problem is that there was a statute of limitations on rape in Michigan back then. It was repealed 6 years later. So if I was born like a few years later, I would have been able to go back and do that. But because I was born before the statute of limitations was repealed, I can't prosecute him. But I am the proof of what he did. And now his whole family knows what he did.
That's good. Anyway,
given that he has Alzheimer's, I'm sure pretty soon he won't know what he did.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how quickly it'll deteriorate, but one day I will look in his casket. I haven't met him. I don't want to meet him, but one day I'll look in his casket, and that'll be my closure.
Just look down his corpse and smile.
Just closure.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Now, to get on to another question, now clearly religion plays a good part in what you do. Some people who aren't religious might be turned off by that. So do you try to give secular arguments against abortion so many people can relate to them?
Yeah.
And tell the audience your beliefs as well.
I learned my pro-life values from my atheist Jewish grandmother. My grandfather had wanted her to kill my aunt. And she said, I never loved him again after that. And she'd cry, how could they do that? How could they kill the babies? And I had a face to the issue when I was 14 years old. I was horrified to learn that my grandfather had wanted my aunt to be killed. My pro-life views had nothing to do with religion. And as I said, when I was in law school, I wrote that essay because I was so frustrated. I mean, even back then, that's all you'd hear is that, you know, that you're a Bible thumper or something if you are against abortion. And like, what does that have to do with anything? I was, you know, living as an atheist or an agnostic basically at that point. And so I thought, you know, I'm going to write a defense, you know, and in a sense I was defending my own life, but I mean, I'm alive. What do I have to lose? You know, I'm safe. Like I want to go back and save others. I feel like my life was saved from a burning building. So I want to defend others who are just as worthy of protection as I was. Because my birth mother tried to kill me at 2 illegal abortions and told me she would have aborted me if it had been legal. And I owe my birth to the law, which protected me. That has nothing to do with religion. She did not choose life for me. She chose abortion. So yeah, when I speak at university campuses, it is entirely a secular presentation. Because there's no way I'm going to let them get away with dismissing my story by saying, oh, well, you know, I don't believe in God. I believe in the Bible. So who cares? They're not going to get away with that.
And what are your beliefs?
Well, today I know my worth. I mean, I do have faith. You know, I will tell you, like, the secular worldview is kind of rough because there's a lot of people would say, like, oh, life's what you make of it. No big deal. Just move on. You know, or they'll say, oh, the power's within you to overcome, you know, whatever. And, like, you know, if the power was within me, like, God help me because I was a mess, you know? Yeah. So, you know, I mean, a secular worldview, I think, would suggest that I was a mistake. You know, maybe that I was tainting the gene pool, that it's, you know, I'm a product of evolution, or that I am a product of a rapist and that I'm here because of rape. I think a secular worldview, you know, if people find their value and identity, their roots are in who they're in their genealogy, right? And I was kind of floating. I didn't really feel like I had roots. And when I found those roots, like I didn't like that. And that wasn't very good. So I struggled for years with those issues. And, you know, I think a secular worldview would also put forth a success model that your value is kind of based upon what you do with your life. And, you know, be an overcomer. You know, motivational speakers, you know, would say if you could just make something of yourself, you could be somebody. And that there's sort of this utilitarian philosophy then that, you know, and survival of the fittest. And just like I said, life's what you make of it. And so I was kind of on that success path or model that if I could make myself attractive and successful and become a lawyer, then I'll have value and people could look at me and see that I'm worthy of living. And I really didn't know my own worth. And today, if someone asks me, what is your worth? Like, I'm not going to open up my portfolio, my investments. I'm not going to share with you what my net worth is. I'm not going to tell you how much money I earn. Like, that's not my worth. You know, and it's also not what I do with my life and what my achievements are, what my accomplishments are, or successes or my failures, because I had a lot of failures. You know, it's not based upon being a mom or anything else. I know my worth now, and it has nothing to do with any of that. And it's through that I'm able to see that everyone has an infinite worth, no more, no less than anyone else. But, you know, I am God's gift to this world, and you are too.
Christian, Jewish, deist?
I'm Christian, yeah.
Yeah, I know you said you used to be, I know you said you weren't a religious Jew.
You said I'm what?
Oh, I said, I know you had said, like, in an interview that you weren't a religious Jew.
Right. I mean, I went to 5 years of Hebrew school 3 days a week. I learned my Haftorah. I had to chant it in Hebrew. And we did a Passover Seder every year, you know, lit the menorah for Hanukkah. But God was irrelevant in our household. I never saw my parents pray, you know, except for saying the, you know, rote prayers like that were in Hebrew.
Kind of defeats the purpose of having Passover.
Yeah, I have much more of an understanding of Passover now than I did back then.
Yeah, a lot of people will be like, well, it doesn't matter anyway because the Exodus never happened, but that's a whole conversation. It did happen, but not on that scale.
I mean, look, growing up, I learned a few things. You don't date a goy. Okay, that's a derogatory Yiddish term for Gentile. Okay, you definitely don't marry a goy, and it would be unfathomable to become one. You know, that would be like the greatest betrayal. And with my parents, like, I might as well.
Boy, what's it called?
Goy.
Goy.
You've never heard that? You didn't grow up around a lot of Jews.
I heard it on your interview.
Yeah, so it means Gentile. I was also called a shiksa because I had really blonde hair. And that, again, a derogatory Yiddish term for Gentile girl. But, you know, my dad, there's certain things like you don't date a goy. You don't put up a Christmas tree. And you don't eat pork. My dad didn't eat pork and had nothing to do with faith. It was just this sort of Jewish pride that was their Jewish identity.
I mean, there's no point in it if you're not bound by those laws.
It was just like, that's the difference between us and the goys. You know, we didn't have pork in the house. That was it.
Well, I mean, I'm sure the pigs are happy.
We ate shrimp though, which is interesting because shrimp actually violates those kosher laws. So
fish.
They drove on Saturdays and they worked and all that other stuff. So they weren't keeping any laws. And so I would say to my dad, like, you know, this just has to do with tradition. And I was 15 when I first became a Christian, and he's like, that's right, tradition. And he'd sing Fiddler from the Roof, you know, that song Tradition.
No.
Like, he just thought it was a joke, you know, he didn't care.
How did your family take that? You accepting Yeshua?
I freaked out. They took me to see a rabbi who dipped me in water when I was 3 years old. It's called a mikveh, which actually means, like, translates to blessing. But it was like, think of the laws, if you're familiar with the Bible, how the baptism of John, when John was baptizing people before Jesus came and the Holy Spirit descended, you know, he was cleansing people. It was this cleansing ritual. And so that's because I was adopted and I wasn't adopted from a Jewish family. I had to have this mikveh performed on me in order to be made Jewish. And this is what the rabbi explained to me when I was 15 and I had become a Christian. My parents freaked out. It was like as if I had joined a cult. And then they said something you always hear, which is you are whatever your mother's religion is. Like, that's like the law of the Talmud, apparently, that if you marry a Jewish girl, you know, then the children have to be raised Jewish. Like, as far as they're concerned, that's the Jewish law. And then the children are automatically Jewish. And that's why it was like a really bad thing for a Jewish guy to marry a shiksa, because then the children don't have to be raised Jewish. They're not Jewish, you know? So this was explained to me, and I said to my dad and with the rabbi there, so this has nothing to do with faith? And my dad's like, that's right, tradition. You know, like, it's absurd, really absurd.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, we've gotten out in the weeds.
All right, yeah. So Now, what are some misconceptions that you've heard from pro-lifers who are for the rape exception and pro-choicers in general?
Wait, state it again, sorry.
All right. Now, what are some misconceptions that you've heard from pro-lifers who are for the rape exception and pro-choicers in general?
And by the way, according to Gallup polls, you know, several different polls show that about 60% of pro-life people make the rape exception. But we have a 5-state study that was commissioned by Georgia Right to Life, Personhood, and Right to Life in Michigan. And it, in a 1-hour online interactive study, we showed that you could dramatically sway people's opinion on this issue, especially people who were pro-life. It's really easy to change their mind on this issue. Okay. I mean, they're 99% of the way there. I was able to change the heart of Governor Rick Perry during his presidential campaign, as well as Newt Gingrich.
Oh yeah. He's the guy who thinks that Obama and Trump were chosen by God and basically every Republican president.
I don't know about that, but I was able to change the heart of Governor Rick Perry and Newt Gingrich during their presidential campaign. So I find it's very, very easy to change the heart of somebody who makes a rape exception once they meet somebody who was conceived in rape, because you put a face to the issue. And that makes a difference. What I find is that people, for most people, this is just a concept. Even the idea of abortion, you know, you talk about a fetus. Like, did you know that Norma McCorvey, Jane Roe, gave birth to a daughter? I would tell people this for years. I met her. And you read Roe v. Wade in law school, and it says nothing. You read the opinion of the court, it says nothing about her child. Just talked about a fetus. Well, she gave birth by the time that case reached the Supreme Court. They knew she had a daughter, but they didn't want to humanize that child. It's very important to humanize the child. So you don't have to humanize a child by showing pictures of dead babies that have been killed. You know, you can show pictures of live babies who were conceived in rape and change hearts through stories of people who are alive, you know. And I find it's very easy to do so. They never thought it through. And it's very difficult to look someone in the eyes and say, yeah, I think your mother should have been able to abort you. Like, if I had my way, you'd be dead right now. People don't want to do that. They have a hard time with that. I've changed the hearts of pro-choice activists, radical activists, who said, I can't do that. You're a good person. I can't look you in the eyes and say that.
So I think the misconception is that it is said that you'll always be like, you know, a woman should have a child, should be allowed to abort, because the baby will always be a reminder of the worst moment of her life.
Yeah.
We got bits and pieces of what you said.
So he said that one of the misconceptions, and this is true, is that the child would be a horrible reminder. And that's not true. The book Victims and Victors outlines much of this research. But, you know, I have a global organization, Save the One, with a network of over 1,000 of us who were conceived in rape and mothers from rape, mostly mothers from rape. And they express that, you know, their child is not a horrible reminder. Their child is a reminder that good can overcome evil, a reminder that a child brings healing, a reminder that a child is innocent and has nothing to do with any of that. So no, the child's not a horrible reminder, and that is a myth. That's absolutely a myth. And again, it's an insult to rape victims to suggest that, and it's an insult to them to call their child the rapist child. Because let me tell you, those rape victim mothers hate hearing their child called the rapist child, because it's like, excuse me? They're like, after everything I've been through, you're going to suggest that my child belongs to him? He should have no rights to this child at all. And so, yeah, those are the myths that are put out there.
And from what I can tell, most
most women that get pregnant from rape, they actually end up keeping the child.
Yeah. So the studies, there's two studies that are cited by Dr. David Reardon. And one, basically on average, it says that over 50% choose to parent, 25% choose adoption, and depending on the study, 15 to 25% choose abortion, which is actually half the rate of the average unplanned pregnancy. Nationwide, an unplanned pregnancy is over 50% abort, and only 1% choose adoption now in unplanned pregnancies. But it's interesting that rape victims are basically choosing adoption instead of abortion. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them, say that they choose adoption because they want their child to have what they didn't have, want their child to have what they had, or they want their child to have two parents, they absolutely want to make sure that their rapist doesn't have parental rights. Now we're changing the laws and that rape victims have more protection so that they don't have to feel, that adoption to be safe. But I think it's really interesting that, what they express is that they don't want more violence in the exact place where they were already traumatized. They don't want more violence. I think most people assume that almost all rape victims would want an abortion, and they're shocked to hear that the numbers are so low.
Yeah. I think, what people need to realize is that no matter what the woman does, she's going to undergo more trauma, whether she goes through with the birth or whether she gets an abortion. Because from what I've heard, abortion is a very invasive and what many people call a violent procedure to the very parts that were violated to begin with.
Yeah, I mean, even taking the abortion pill is violent. It's extremely violent. And it's just absurd to think that more violence is going to bring healing. It does not. But a baby does have a way of bringing tremendous healing. Mm-hmm. What these rape victims say is that, a lot of them say that when they were raped, they felt a death inside their body and that they felt like they were dead inside. And they may have initially contemplated abortion, but as time went on, they marveled at the fact that this dead body now had life growing inside. And when all they felt before was darkness, now there's this spark of light that's coming from the child. A lot of rape victims, after being raped, they don't engage in self-care. And they express that where they didn't care about taking care of themselves, now all of a sudden, knowing that there was a baby there, it gave them reason to start engaging in self-care again, because they cared about the well-being of their child, even if they didn't care about themselves. Mm-hmm. You understand that?
Yeah, I can get that. What do you say when someone tells you that you're not really pro-life, but just pro-birth, and that pro-lifers just want to control women by, say, not allowing them to go to school and instead be just being housewives?
No, I want to empower women to be able to go to school, graduate. You're not a feminist if you think that a woman has to kill her own child in order to be successful. That is not what a feminist is. A feminist says you can do it. You can have a baby and go to school and graduate and be a movie star. You can. Okay, that's what a feminist would say. A feminist would say, you are able and I will help you. But instead, today's feminists are like, yeah, you need to kill your baby to be a success. It's really pathetic.
I mean, and what I also note, I said, what do I, like, as a man, what do I really gain from, like, what do I stand to gain from convincing a woman to have a child? Like, you would think that, you know, I have very little to gain from that, because let's say, for example, a woman does decide to drop out, like, not pursue college or whatever, and then I'm with her. Well, that means I have to step up. I have to do more work. I have to do the education and stuff. I have to fill the gap that would otherwise be there. So ultimately, I would have to do more work to support the child and my, the woman. And another thing is, like, I would say, well, I mean, wouldn't abortion be the just most convenient thing for a man that just wants to treat women bad? Because basically that means they have license to treat women really bad and just like say, well, she's just going to get an abortion anyway, so why do I worry? So, if, you know, a guy will just say, well, you know, if she gets an abortion, I won't be on child support.
Yeah, yeah. And as I said, I'm a family law attorney. And as a young attorney, I did a lot of court-appointed paternity work representing fathers or putative fathers, as they're called, who were being sued for paternity and child support. And this is before the internet was even popular, but this there was already cliche that these guys would, I'd meet with them and over again, I'd hear them say, why should I have to pay for it? I mean, that's all the child was to them, wasn't it?
It.
You know, I offered to pay for an abortion, or she could have had an abortion. My last girlfriend had an abortion. You know, why should I have to pay? And I realized really quickly, because it was so common, that it's not a right to an abortion. It was an expectation to abort. You know, like they were like, get with the program. You know, why should I have to pay for this baby? She should have, could have had an abortion.
Or you could have just not had sex and just jerk off.
Yeah, seriously. But, I mean, there was actually two cases that went up to the Michigan Supreme Court on that issue. One of them, one of these guys argued that he shouldn't have to pay child support, or that she lied about being on birth control, so he shouldn't have to pay child support. And the court said, no, it has to do with the right of the child. It's not the right of the mother. The child has the right to support. It has nothing to do with the parent's behavior. And basically said, you had a one-shot chance to avoid responsibility, you know, like in their own words, they said, yeah, you didn't have to, you know, do what you did. And then the second case, they argued that it should mitigate the amount of child support. And the court rejected that and said, no, this is the right of the child to be supported. It has nothing to do with the mother. There's... I've seen some other cases. People have, you know, argued this, that, or the other. Oh, he said he had a vasectomy, or, you know, she said that, you know, whatever. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter. It's the right of the child to be supported.
Isn't it true that many women who get an abortion suffer due to suicidal thoughts and, I believe, a more likely chance to die from the surgery?
Yeah, actually, for rape victims, they're 4 times more likely to die within the next year after the abortion. They have a higher murder rate because it helps perpetuate abusive relationships. We know that rapists, sex traffickers, and child molesters love abortion because it destroys the evidence and allows them to continue perpetrating. But when the girl gives birth, not only does the rape end for her, but for the other young girls in the household who are being raped. So the baby is the one who ends up delivering her out of that abusive situation.
That's another good reason.
Mm-hmm. Rapists.
Being evident.
Abortion protects rapists and child molesters. Absolutely. We see that over and over again. We have so many women in our organization who are post-abortive, and all the abortion did was to protect the rapist. And then also, and again, they have a higher suicide rate because more violence does not bring healing. and a higher rate of drug overdose, domestic violence, and, you know, throughout their lives, and on and on. So if you really care about pregnant rape victims, you should want to protect them from the rapist and from the abortion, not the baby. The baby is not the scary enemy.
Mm-hmm. Now, we already went into the whole sentience question, so I'm going to skip that part and go to the final question. Do you have any experience with crisis pregnancy centers? And if so, would you say they are good clinics and not so-called fake clinics like Planned Parenthood says?
Yeah, actually, we call them pregnancy resource centers nowadays instead of crisis pregnancy. They're trying to, like, not have a negative connotation. My local pregnancy resource center actually does more than just pregnancy testing and free ultrasounds. They actually do free STI testing for sexually transmitted infections. A lot of pregnancy resource centers are going to this model where they're doing, they're going, you know, more medical. And so no, they're not fake clinics. And I've done videos on, I post on YouTube or Facebook at pregnancy centers, and I show people the photos and images of the baby's closet, the clothing closet with maternity clothes and diapers and wipes and everything you can imagine that, that a woman would need, and baby clothes, and, you know, they don't have anything like that at the abortion clinic. You know, all they offer is death.
I know, pretty much. I believe it said that they don't offer mammograms at Planned Parenthood.
Nope, no mammograms at Planned Parenthood.
Even though they've been given a budget increase, but yet they're going down on everything except abortion.
Yeah. And it's horrible that they're kept open during COVID-19.
Oh, yeah, that's even more disturbing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, don't they know that's going to expose more women to the disease?
Yeah, I mean, Maryland, which was, you know, it's a very liberal state, their governor shut down the abortion clinics.
And they like to say churches are the only ones staying open.
I know, it's just, I mean, I would consider church more essential than an abortion clinic.
Yeah, where I live in Michigan, our governor is like the worst, Governor Whitmer. Oh, she's so horrible. She tried to shut down the sidewalk counselors outside of the abortion clinics, and they won a court battle now, so she has to let them be out there. But, you know, she's kept the lottery open, but you're not allowed to buy seeds. You know, she doesn't want you doing gardening. It's absurd.
Well, I mean, at least they're being consistent in the fact that, well, we'll keep the place open, that will kill your seed, and you also can't go to the store to buy other seeds.
Yeah.
So they very much have a problem. I mean, what I always found funny about when they say about fetus.
You're fading away there.
I said, what's funny about the whole, they use the word fetus to dehumanize the unborn. I'm saying, you better realize that fetus is just Latin for offspring. It literally just means baby.
Or little one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, when I was a young attorney, I had like several high profile cases and I had to write legal briefs. They were pro bono, you know, cases where I represented women for free. Four of the cases involved, they were all pro-life cases, two involved rape and abortion. And when I was writing my legal briefs, I did a search under Michigan law in the Michigan courts, Michigan Court of Appeals and Supreme Court. And any time that the child was a wanted child, so-called wanted child, so if the case involved adoption or medical malpractice, or a drunk driver that killed an unborn child. Any of those circumstances, didn't matter gestationally the age of the child when the harm occurred, they used the term unborn child. But the same court, if the case involved abortion, then they used the term fetus. And it did not matter gestationally what age. It was purely based upon whether you were talking about unborn child in the context of abortion or some other context, like an inheritance case, you know. And it just shows, like, the law is schizophrenic and they're just total hypocrites.
Yeah, I've noticed that pretty much when it comes to the language. I mean, even many abortion practicing doctors are just stop making that distinction. They just say, yeah, we kill babies. Yep. Deal with it.
Yep. There's an abortion clinic near me in my area, Northland Family Planning. It's about a half hour from me in, I think, Southfield, Michigan. And they have women, they said that women, that they couldn't deny post-abortion stress, you know, that there was post-abortion regret for some women. Like, they can't deny that anymore, right? Mm-hmm. And so they felt that the reason why women had this regret is because they didn't properly say goodbye. And so they go through this whole process. They make it like a spa where there's like aromatherapy and soft music, like you're going to a day at the spa. And they have them write a letter to the soul, the spirit of their child, and you know, telling them why they're a good mom and affirming that they're a good mom making this choice for their child. And then they like release it with like balloons, like the letter with like a balloon up in the sky and release the spirit of that child. I was like, are you kidding me?
That kind of reminds me of this this New Atheist apologist, Dillahunty. His best argument against religion is the trauma that women feel over having their fetuses having funerals at hospitals, Catholic hospitals.
Oh,
and like we give funerals to pretty much everyone else.
No, you know what? There's so many post-abortive women who go to visit these grave sites because they have no other place to go to mourn the loss of their child.
Yeah. Well, we're coming up. We've been a little past the hour mark here. Yeah, I got all my questions done. Do you got anything you want to ask? Codes?
Who's Codes?
Just say it. Do you have anything you want to add?
Other than that, it was good to have you on. Any final thoughts?
I'll tell you one final story, quick story. My youngest daughter, Contessa, when she was 6.5 years old, she asked me how to spell the word conceived. I thought, like, what do you want to know how to spell conceived? She said, I'm writing a book. It's a surprise. And, you know, my children know my story. They know what abortion is. They know what rape is in the sense that, you know, you have to protect your privates and that your privates are anything that's not that. It's covered by a bathing suit and that nobody's to touch them without permission. And that when they do, like, that's called rape, like, without telling them really graphic details. Like, they understood from a young age. Like, what's sad is a lot of parents, like, you teach your kids to keep the diapers on, right, from a young age. And you teach them to cover their privates, but you don't give them a word for it. And there's children who are molested and they don't know what to call what's being done to them. And so it's like, in a sense, you're not really helping them. So they know the word rape and they know that I was conceived in rape and that conceived means that that's when I was created. Again, without like a lot of scientific details at a young age, they had some understanding and they've traveled all over with me speaking. So, and they know that a bad guy hurt Grandma Joanne. So this is what my daughter wrote at 6.5 years old. Conceived in rape is not bad because that's my mom. Rape is bad and abortion is bad because they both hurt people.
Yeah.
Why can't everyone just understand that basic truth? Like, because I'm not bad. Like, that truth. The child conceived in rape is not bad. A 6-year-old understands that. Why can't everybody understand that?
Oppressing women by not giving them the option to choose is bad, they'll say.
Choose what, though? Choose what? To hurt another person. They both hurt people. Rape and abortion both hurt people. And man, I wish politicians could just say that, you know, just don't try to, you know, confuse the issue. Just keep it simple.
Well, I mean, what I would just say is that all laws are, again, like they penalize certain choices that people make. Like, if the person chooses to rape someone, that's a choice they made and we penalize them for it. So our whole legal system acknowledges that there are choices that people make that are bad.
Yeah. And, you know, I don't want to control women's bodies, but, you know, you don't have an absolute right to decide what can happen to your own body. And a lot of, you know, pro-life people, conservatives will throw out like, yeah, we regulate drugs and we regulate prostitution. And then quickly the liberals will be like, yeah, those things should be legal. But the one area of the law that everyone agrees is the right of self-defense, that it is a limited right to the extent that it affects what happens to other people. So you're not allowed to use lethal force to prevent a harm from occurring unless you're presented with lethal force. And I think that that's something we can all appreciate. It's not an absolute right. So like if you step on my foot or you're about to step on my foot, I don't have an absolute right not to have my foot stepped on. Like I can't try to kill you to prevent you from bumping into me. You know, that would be scary if we lived in a world where there was an absolute right to decide what could happen in and to your own body. You know, where you could just use lethal force to prevent harms from occurring. Like, I was beat up by a boyfriend from law school. He broke my jaw. I lost my front tooth. Under the law, I did not have the right to kill him to prevent that from occurring. And I have pain that I'll have for the rest of my life. And disfigurement, and I've been through a lot to.
What happened? Did you kick his ass or have called cops on him or whatever?
I called the police, but they said even if they found that we were out of state at the time, and they couldn't make him give me any money right then. I had to get home. My summer semester was starting for law school, and I didn't have any money to stay. And I would have had to stay in a shelter, and I would have had to come back for all the hearings and everything. So he never got arrested. He never became a lawyer, by the way, because I did report him to the bar. So he never became a lawyer. But yeah. But in any way, I didn't have the right to kill him to prevent that permanent bodily damage from occurring. I didn't have the right to kill him. And I believe in that, you know, we decide that human life is more precious and you can only use lethal force if you're presented with lethal force. So this whole idea of you have a right to decide what happens to your body is total BS. We should all be happy that there's no such absolute right, because we'd all have to be afraid anytime. We would definitely be standing 6 feet apart from people. You know, at all times. It would be like quarantine, because if you accidentally bump somebody and they have a right to kill you to prevent you from bumping them, I mean, that would be a really terrifying world to live in.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I would have just said bodily autonomy just means that you have the right to use your body for justice without coercion.
You faded out.
I said, to me, I've always considered bodily autonomy to be the right to use your body as a just means without coercion. Like, for example, if I want to use my body to buy a candy bar from the store, I shouldn't be coerced by anyone or forced by the law to not be able to use my body for that position. However, if I use my body to grab a gun and hold the guy up for a candy bar at the store, well, no, I don't have the right to do that with my body. So I think just means is always what goes into cases of bodily autonomy in my part. And I said, you know, they forget how the law works, where the law doesn't actually take away a right. I mean, it doesn't take away a choice. It just penalizes choices made.
In my philosophical abortion essay, I use the example of the safe harbor doctrine. And I use a lot of legal concepts in it, but you know, I have a whole discussion of rights and duties, and you know, do you, in order to have a right, does someone have to invite you to exercise that right? And I explain why rights and duties have nothing to do with invitations, that just the rights and duties exist regardless of whether there's an invitation to exercise those rights. And the example I use is the safe harbor doctrine. So if you have a dock in a storm and there's a ship where the only way for them to be safe is to dock there, having an empty dock is not you constructively inviting them to dock their ship. They don't need an invitation because we deem that life is more precious and they have a right to dock there in order to preserve life. That's the safe harbor doctrine and the law. And so that's just an example where you see that you don't have to have an invitation in order to have rights and duties.
I also believe that, correct me if I'm wrong with this, but if a person threatens, like, to kill you unless you kill someone else, would you still be charged with murder for killing if you actually went through with it and killed the person?
I actually have a discussion of that in my essay. No, the law says that you do not have a right to kill someone else in order to prevent yourself from being killed. You have to be at risk. We do have the innocent aggressor rule, however, though, that says that if there's a child who has a gun that you know to be loaded, the only way to save your own life is to shoot that child, to kill that child. We say that not that what you did was right, but that we choose not to punish under those circumstances because we understand that preservation of one's own life is a basic human instinct. And that's called the innocent aggressor rule. And so that's kind of how I feel when it comes to the right of abortion, where they say, like, oh, life of the mother, which, you know, there's really very, very rare circumstances that would ever be life of the mother. And like ectopic pregnancy. And, you know, in that case, the baby can't survive anyway. But, you know, I believe in the right to prematurely terminate a pregnancy, which is not the same thing as the right to kill an unborn child, because I prematurely terminated 3 of my pregnancies and my daughters are all quite well, you know, because I induced labor. I didn't go in and kill them, right? So you can prematurely terminate a pregnancy without having a dead baby. So I always ask people, well, you know, which kind of termination are you talking about? The one with the live baby or the dead babies? Because if it's the termination where it's a live baby, I have no problem with that. I just don't want the terminations with the dead baby.
Yeah, I've always said that's funny because that's how they usually phrase it, where an abortion is just any procedure that results in the termination of a pregnancy. And I'm saying, well, basically every birth that happens in a hospital where they have procedures is a successful abortion. And I'm like, that really is too broad.
Yeah, I mean, to abort a mission is to prematurely terminate the mission, you know.
Right? Well, I also believe that, you know, like, at least in a technical terms, you know, a birth just means that the baby has came out of the mother. You know, whether it happens through a C-section or through regular means.
Yeah.
So I always like to say that an abortion, and this was actually common knowledge, even with the term abortion, was meant to force a birth, a premature birth.
I use this example in my essay again. I talk about the C-section, talk about what does terminate mean, prematurely terminate, live baby, dead baby, all that kind of, and that, you know, these people that act like they're confused, like they don't understand the abortion rights advocates. And I mentioned Macbeth. I was an English major in undergrad before I went to law school. So I love Shakespeare, but I don't know if you're familiar with Macbeth at all, but there's the three prophecies from the witches, right? Prophecy. And Macduff at the end, when Macbeth, you know, he's like, you know, ha ha, like I cannot be killed. He's basically saying, because, you know, one of the prophecies of no man, woman born shalt thou be killed, you know, and he's like bragging, saying like, you can't kill me because there's this prophecy. And Macduff says, you know, basically, ha ha, I was from my mother's womb untimely ripped. You know, so like he wasn't like woman born. He was, you know, from a cesarean section. And it reminds me like Macbeth, like not getting it and being so clueless. Like the parole boards remind me of him, you know, that like.
Well, to be fair, the average person won't get it until it's revealed, until he outright says it.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, you got any future projects you want the dear audience to know about?
Well, I mean, just, you know, please check out my website, RebeccaKiesling.com. But more importantly, I would really like you to check out my organization's website, Save the One. And that's the number one, not the word one. SaveTheOne.com. On our blog, we have like over 250 articles written. We specialize in defending all of the so-called hard cases in the abortion debate through our personal stories. So conceived in rape, mothers from rape, incest or sex trafficking, post-abortive from rape, birth mothers from rape, and hundreds who were told by doctors to abort. So challenging prenatal diagnosis, health of the mother, life of the mother, anything that would be considered a difficult case, that's our specialty. And we have tons of great blogs written. You can look by category. And I've written a lot of policy pieces there. I've written stuff on the law. And follow our Facebook page. We have lots of great videos and memes and lots of good articles, like regularly, again, like focusing on the so-called difficult cases. We kind of do stuff that like no one else specializes in, but we're also a resource to the pro-life movement. So if you're part of an organization and you want to take the image of someone that where it was posted on our blog, maybe there's a story you really liked and you know, you want to make a meme out of it, you want to take a quote, like, go ahead and use it. You can put your organization's name on it. Like, we don't care. Like, we just want to be a resource to the pro-life movement. You have permission. Use our stories. You know, we just want to have our stories out there. And, you know, when others share it, it just multiplies our efforts. And I think there needs to be more cooperation within the pro-life movement. So, yeah, please go ahead and share our stories. And then, you know, we have like 24 national speakers, and we have about 70 speakers like regionally all over the country, around the world. So if you need a pro-life speaker, you can contact us. We can find someone local, or you can look at our national speakers. And they're all trained, excellent speakers.
All right. Any final thoughts, Brass?
No, I actually had a very nice time. It was nice talking to you, Rebecca.
Thank you. I had a nice time too, guys. So I hope I meet you in person sometime. Do you guys go to the March for Life or anything?
No.
No, it never happens in my area.
Or mine.
But I am making sure to stay active. I wrote a book. Like I said before, like I wrote a book actually going into my position on pro-life and making a philosophical defense of the pro-life position.
Well, I really appreciate you guys defending life. Your voices matter. It's so important to have men involved. You know, if you look around the pro-life movement, nowadays it's really dominated by women. And honestly, I just think there need to be a lot more men. You'd be a great opportunity to be a role model for young men. And you know, I like having men defend us. You know, I think it's fabulous. I feel like, you know, you were made for this. So don't let society shut your voice down. And I really appreciate you.
All right.
Go follow our guests on social media, subscribe, share, and see you next time.